All right, today is the day, and somewhere out there in the world of social media, there are a few doubters. Imagine that. They may be bitter couch critics venting their frustrations of a poorly planned life. Or maybe they're just uninformed. Well, I better be a better man and say that it's all my fault. I've not been successful in showing the process, the theory, or the execution of the fabrication of this monocoque tub. And there are a few doubts out there. Well, then that means there's probably more people that also have that same question. So we're going to take and answer that question right now. Let's go take a look. In engineering, we like to refer to any structural element subject to bending as a beam. In a previous video, we tested some beams. Although somewhat flat as beams go, still a beam in the engineer's eye. Well, I'll put a link to that video in the description and a link at the end of this video on one of the cards there. But for now, the summary of that video was that we found that multiple layers of lighter fabric proved to be a lot stronger than a singular layer of some heavy fabric, meaning more strength for the same mass. Now this occurs for the same reason that composites in general offer any form of strength, compression and tension. You've probably seen an engineering drawing like this, showing how a material or beam under load has part of the structure under compression and part under tension. This is the basis of all composite structures. In any structure, you're starting with a material that has properties that are either good under compression or good under tension, and combining them. Well, sometimes those materials are good at both compression and tension. All the better. Well, here we have a bundle of fiberglass tow strands. They're a little bit better right now under tension than they are under compression. But fiberglass is actually very strong in compression as well. Right now, the only chance these have of acting as a beam is maybe by a little bit of a friction. Yeah, we tied them up into a bundle, we could enhance that friction and get it to stand out maybe a little bit better, but not very much. Now if we add a bit of epoxy, and now a matrix has been created that forces the material to go into a mode where the load side is under compression and the opposite side under tension. A much better beam. Composite cloths are thousands of bundles of fibers waiting to join in a matrix. In fact, thousands of strands of fibers make up what is known as a tow, and then the tows are woven or bonded together. In fact, carbon fiber is often designated by the number of fibers in each tow. Here in this 2K twill fabric, each bundle of fibers has, well, you guessed it, 2K or 2,000 strands. And of course, when you add resin to a piece of cloth, you get many bundles all in there working together. Now, as you stack these layers together, you start to compound the benefits. That's why, as we mentioned in the previous video, multiple layers have some layers in compression and other layers in tension. Not just the individual fibers of the bundle acting in compression or tension. So just like those loose fibers, we bond multiple layers together and we're starting to get a very strong panel. Another trick we have is that the further apart the compression and tension planes are, the stronger the beam. So in this case, we can laminate a piece of foam between the layers of fiberglass, adding more rigidity to the panel. The same theory as in an I-beam, two masses separated by a webbing. One under compression and one under tension. Now cores are great. We can add a lot of strength without adding a lot of weight, as we would if we were just adding more fiber layers. But the real secret to put your strength over the top is geometrics. How your part is shaped can play more into its strength than the amount of material itself. How much? Well, let's make up some samples and we can do some testing to find out for sure. Now these samples are all gonna be different, but the same. I mean the same in that we're going to use the same amount of fiberglass for each one of these samples. We're going to be using 3 layers of a 6 ounce fabric. Now, as you see, each one's going to be a little bit different in form and shape and some cores and other things. First one, of course, was just 3 layers plain on a flat sheet. Our second one here, we've stretched a piece of plastic around a piece of wood, and we're going to create just an arch form. And on the third, I've made a mold of this little shape here, look like a potato. That's just gonna be kind of a piece that we're gonna call the blister. Again, everything is gonna be made out of just 3 layers, the same 3 layers of fabric from sample to sample. Now I've got the first 3 done and we're gonna move on to another set, and these are gonna be the samples that have cores in them. So I put down 2 layers of fabric and then the core, and then put another layer over the top. And that's the way it's going to be tested. 2 layers under compression, 1 under tension. And then I've made another one here that we're wrapping the fiberglass around on the other side, and that's going to work the opposite of the other core sample. And this blister with a back on it, and then a third blister is two layers with a core in the middle and a layer. And the final sample, we're going to skip away from the three layers just as a kind of a test piece to show what happens when you add multiple layers. We have 9 layers of a unidirectional fabric.
This is our test rig. I wouldn't say it is unscientific. It's very scientific. It may be not super accurate, but it will be accurate enough to show us exactly what we're trying to display. Okay, so our sample is going to go between these two. We've got these little foots here. So that's going to be our maximum span so that it keeps our distance the same on all the samples here. We're going to put our samples in between those things. Take this strap, it'll go over the sample. Fill the bucket with water. We know the weight of water, so we'll know when it fails. Let's give it a run.
Put the strap over the top and things are ready to go. I started thinking this whole thing through and thought that the weight would be enough out of these buckets, and certainly thought so as this testing began. Knowing that we could just pour water into these buckets to get our weight, knowing the weight of water at 8.3 pounds, something right in there, we can just keep adding it. When the panel failed, we could just measure how much water we had added. And of course, measuring the water as we add it, because I didn't want it to fail, bucket tip over and lose our water, and then try to remember how much water I put in there. So a little slow in our demonstration here, but we will be measuring at the water and pouring it in. We get a gallon in there, we can already see some flexing going on in that panel. And the whole testing procedure seemed to be working just fine. Going on to our second gallon, and we are really seeing some stress in that panel already. Going for another load of water. As we pour that in there, we're about halfway through our bucket when, it is getting really close. Add a little bit, and there's our fail. Failing at about 2.7 gallons of water, somewhere right in there.
Okay, 22 that would have pounds. Been 3 gallons.
So now moving on to our next sample. Same three layers of fiberglass, this time formed into an arch. Forming it into an arch pushes more layers into the compression and tension area. But how much is the difference going to be by just forming this into an arch? Now we start off doing the same thing, pouring our water into our bucket. And as I'll try to run these videos up as fast as I can, be able to explain what's going on in the midst of it all. But 2 gallons, going on to 3 gallons, 4 gallons, our bucket's getting pretty full. And we're about to find out that we got a little bit of a problem with this test rig. So we're gonna have to switch things up. Empty the water out. I rounded up some iron weights that I have. We're gonna load up the bucket with some iron before we go back to the water. I think I got 40 pounds of iron in there or so. And now I know I can't quite fit 5 gallons of water in there, but I think 4. And we can see our sample is really tilting over, Dale. About to give way, and there it goes. Failure. It didn't fracture, but bent and fell over at 86 pounds. Moving on to the next step, the blister. Same three layers of fabric, same amount of resin, this time formed into the shape of this little blister. Go find some more weights, see if I can do this. Got a big aluminum billet, steel billet, back to my iron window weights. Load this thing up with as much weight as we can get in there before we start adding water. But then I find out the whole fallacy behind this whole test rig is that these samples are proving to be stronger than I even anticipated. Because as I pour this thing up, I get the bucket full, iron, water, all full, and it's not going to fail. So back to the drawing board, create myself a new way to add some more weight, and of course anything I can find to make up that weight, which happened to be some cinder blocks. I believe they weighed out at about 33 pounds for a large cinder block and 17 for a half block. And I just put them on a cantilevered beam strap going down through it. And as you can see, I'm getting almost all my cinder blocks on there. And that blister's starting to deform. It's starting to cave in on the sides where the strap is putting some pressure on the sides. And I've run out of cinder blocks here. Same problem I had with the water. So I've thrown on the iron weights, and this thing is getting crushed down, and it is really getting smashed in. But it's certainly taking this whole load. And that whole load is calculated out at 289 pounds. But instead of add more, we've gone to the next sample. Now this is our foam core sample here. We're just going to swap it out with our blister that never did fail. But we're going away from the pure layers and adding some more components to this, and that is our foam cores. Now this one has two layers under compression, one under tension. The next sample will be just opposite. And there will be a little bit of a difference just by switching out how that works. Now one thing that's a little bit different between testing with the water and the cinder blocks is every time I add a block, it's instant load increase rather than with the water. You can slowly increase the load and not put that sudden pressure on there that can cause things to fail really easily. But we're getting our blocks on there, and you can see that that panel is starting to deform already. I'm not going to be able to make it, it doesn't look like, to the iron. Just going to get some cinder blocks on there. Even kind of freaks me out, this thing's going to come flying pretty soon. Find myself another block. Oh, no time, because it failed. 222 pounds. Now here's the other foam core sample. Like I said, just opposite of the last one. And we think that we're, of course, gonna get close, so I'm gonna just start loading blocks on there. See what we get to. Last time, 222 pounds, so I think I can just keep, but it failed much earlier at only 133 pounds, showing the difference in the tension and compression needed. Now here's our blister with a layer on the bottom that's going to add a tension layer to the same blister. Now to be able to add that bottom layer on, I had to have a little bit bigger flange just for a bonding area for the bottom layer. And so you can see that that flange is really getting crushed. It's collapsing in the side of the blister. And in fact, you know, throw some iron weights on there just to see what's going to go. But I can tell that that thing's just about to collapse. Not from a failure at 347 pounds. Now, we're going to throw this sample on. We have one more blister to go, but we're going to throw this sample on just to compare to that last blister. Now, this is our 9 layers of unidirectional fiber. And I'm really loading this baby up with everything I can find in the shop. 400 pounds. Under our blister that has a foam core in the middle. Now that foam core is going to spread the loads out. Instead of having a focused load where that strap is going to go on, that foam is going to help us distribute all the forces coming through that strap out to the blister. And I've gone out into the yard and found a couple more pieces of iron. Keep coming into things. Of course, I'm running out of space on the board that's going on here, but I've got a lot of stuff loaded on there, and I've decided that's good enough at 450 pounds. Well, now we've taken a look at how just a little bit of a change in shape, some geometrics, can improve the structure. Now we went from this sample, 9 layers of a unidirectional fiber, down to 3 thin layers of the core in here. Both of these samples holding up over 400 pounds on our test jig. I think we could have pushed a couple hundred more pounds if I'd been able to stack some more weight on there, had something heavier maybe. But anyway, now we've seen how that improves and how those structure changes come about just by changes in the amount of fibers, cores, and some shape changing in there, like we said with the geometrics. So what does all that mean when we go to apply all those principles into the tub, or the monocoque chassis of the Arete car? Well, let's take a walk around and see what we've done to incorporate some of those things that we've just shown in the test here. in the actual structure. Anyway, let's take a little walk around. The thing we're going to see, of course, is that we do not have to have a lot of material involved in these front and rear clamshells because they have so much compound shape in them that they're going to be able to hold their stiffness just by the sheer geometrics involved in our design. Let me show you a little place up here on the front as well. Now we're looking up here right underneath the front fender, and as you see right in this area, still thin enough that it's a little bit translucent. There is probably five layers in here. This is a sample of puck we got here of four layers of an E-glass, but we're using S-glass and most of the structure up here, so even stiffer. Going by that same idea that we have so much form and shape in our geometrics that it's gonna be fairly stiff, we do have stiffeners that we've added in here, little dam buffer, things under here to control some airflow. And then once all these things are decided, we get these things finished, there will be one more layer that bonds the whole thing together. Now this thing only needs to be stiff enough to withstand aerodynamic loads of winds. And I suppose if somebody's gonna be leaning up against it, but no loads for carrying the structure and support of the chassis of the car. So in our monocoque chassis here, we have six pieces of structure that are all tied together. We have these side rails, so one of the side rails on each side, and then we have a floor that's made up of a multi-piece structure, and then we have this very large tunnel, and of course the roof with core materials in it as well. Once you tie all those together, it's kind of like using a bundle of sticks. You know, you can break one stick easy, but you put a bundle together, you can't break it very easily at all. So we have these six pieces that we're tied all together to create that structure going fore and aft. Now we mentioned that we're relying on geometric shape, but that we're also relying on sheer mass of fiber. Going down this structure and on the sides of the tunnel are some fibers that are all unidirectional, meaning those long tapes. I mean, just layers after layers and then built up and then foam cores added and then more of those layers. Those vertical, I keep saying vertical, but they're all horizontal. Those unidirectional fibers all run along this longeron, come up, go into the footwell, and they spread out once they get to the front, make the bend, go around and tie into the bulkheads. Same thing here, they're going into the back, making the turns, tying into the bulkhead, and that vertical, mentioning the vertical laminate in the bulkhead in the back, all these fibers run around, tap into that. So lots of unidirectional fibers running along the sides of these things with foam cores between them. In fact, there is about four layers with foam between them in all this thing, almost a solid piece when you're counting all the foam. Now, one thing that I've done to increase the design of the tub is actually design the subframes so that they attach in points and don't have any hinge action, and they spread the loads out to more places onto the tub. You can see 3 points on the back of the thing because the rear has a little more moment arm with the wheel being further in the back, and on the front subframe attaches, and so is the back also, attaches from the bottom and from the side so that they don't have any, like I said, hinge points. Now this helps that I don't have actual focus loads from the suspension coming in with braking and acceleration, things like that. But that's what you have here, three or four things that influence the design of my fiberglass tub. Now does this description convince you that it will hold together? Or have I fallen into the Dunham-Kruger effect and I don't know enough to know that I don't know enough? Well, have others even attempted this before? Well, we know today that composite tubs or monocoques are fairly common, and some people think that because they don't see fiberglass used in those tubs, they're just not capable of sustaining the loads. Well, this just isn't true. We're going to take a look at some pictures here. The first is going to be the Clan Crusader and the Clover. Lotus Elite, of course, very popular car, and probably the most famous fiberglass load-bearing chassis of all is the Chaparral race cars, the 2A Chaparral cars. Now that car may be considered the forerunner of the F1 carbon fiber monocoque that brought technology into popularity. Now what do all these cars have in common? Low volume. The same still stands with modern supercars, low volume. With a supercar, it's just been accepted that labor intensive process can be absorbed into the tremendously high prices. And with that labor price, why not use carbon fiber as well? Inexpensive cars with fiberglass tub or load bearing chassis just don't calculate out. But if you are doing it yourself and you only get $1 an hour, oh well, labor's cheap. In the end, maybe it will break in half. Most likely, if I've missed something in my design, I'll see some cracks develop before that fatal 200 mile per hour run and either fix it or relegate the car to the Jarvey Museum of Self-Education or whatever. It's only a prototype, or have I not made that clear as well? Anyway, thanks again for coming by. I'll be putting those videos referenced to the video right up here, working with fiberglass and other FRPs, and is carbon fiber worth it? Right over here. Anyway, that's our video for today. Hope you enjoyed it. Come back, see us again.